Hare Krishna. We discussed the first 12 shlokas of the 13th chapter. Arjuna, in the beginning of the chapter, asked 6 questions. He wanted Krishna to elaborate on 6 topics: Jnanam, Gneyam, Prakriti, Purusha, Kshetra, Kshetragna. Krishna described Kshetra and Kshetragna. Kshetra is the body, Kshetragna is the knower of the body, which is both soul and super soul. Jnanam means developing knowledge about the body, soul and super soul is Jnanam. And that knowledge can be acquired by having 20 qualities. Krishna described those 20 qualities: Amanitvam, Adambhitvam, Ahimsa, Kshantir, Arjavam, Acharyopasanam, Shaucham, Sthairyam, Atmavinigraha. These are all various qualities. So thus he answered 3 questions so far: Kshetra, Kshetragna and Jnanam. Now Gneyam he will answer in verses number 13 to 19, he will answer Gneyam. Gneyam is object of knowledge. Okay. We'll discuss 13th sloka. Gneyam yattat pravakshyami.
Gneyam yattat pravakshyami.
Yajnatvam ritamashnute.
Yajnatvam ritamashnute.
Anadimat param brahma.
Anadimat param brahma.
Nasattan nasaduchyate.
Nasattan nasaduchyate.
Gneyam yattat pravakshyami. Arjuna, Krishna is saying now, I will describe Gneyam. Jnanam is knowledge, Gneyam is object of knowledge. That which is knowable is called Gneyam. So, having taught Arjuna the process of attaining knowledge, Krishna will now describe what is to be known, Gneyam. The real objects of knowledge are simple. Again, soul and the super soul. Okay. The Jivatma and the Paramatma. Paramatma is an expansion of Krishna. Okay. So these are the real objects of knowledge. Now you see, Gneyam yattat pravakshyami yat gnatva amritam ashnute. By knowing this Gneyam, by knowing the knowable, knowing the knowable, amritam ashnute, you will attain liberation. Amrita is liberation, immortality. Mrita is death. Amrita means deathlessness or immortality or liberation. Okay. Anadi matparam brahma na sattan nasaduchyati. So that, what is that knowable? Brahman. Brahman is spirit. The spirit soul, jiva, who is anadi, beginningless, matparam, subordinate to the Lord, and brahma. Brahma is the spirit soul, and sadasat na nasattan nasaduchyate, who is beyond the cause and effect of this material world. So that is Brahman, the spirit soul. So this could also slightly refer to the supreme Brahman also. The word Brahman could be the jiva, could be the supreme Lord also, depending on the context. Brahman word could refer to the atma. Sometimes it could be referring to Paramatma also. Here, the words that are saying Mat Param Brahma, that Brahman means that soul, that spirit, which is Mat Param, which is dedicated to Krishna, is knowable. So knowable is what? Gneyam is object of knowledge. So that knowable is basically two things: the Jivatma and Paramatma, both are knowable. So now he is first describing the knowable, which is Atma. So Brahman Matparam, that spirit soul which is dedicated to me, is the object of your knowledge. Please understand your Atma. That's what Krishna says. Gneyam is that the object of knowledge is Atma. You should get self-realization. You should understand about the soul. Is it clear? It's very straightforward explanation. So ultimately that Brahman is beyond the cause and effect of this material world. So next shloka, 14th shloka. Now you see this. The description of Brahman mentioned in this verse is in relation to the individual soul, and when the word Brahman is applied to the living entity, it is to be understood that he is Vijnana Brahma as opposed to Ananda Brahma. Ananda Brahma is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Prabhupada introduces these two terminologies, Vijnana Brahma and Ananda Brahma in the purport. So Prabhupada says this the Brahman referred to in this shloka is spirit soul, the knowable. So we are discussing the topic of Gnayam, or the object of knowledge, and the objects of knowledge are, one, the soul, two, the super soul. The soul is described now, and Krishna will describe in the next several shlokas the super soul, 14th shloka onwards. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. Five shlokas describe various qualities of super soul. Knowing that super soul is also Gnayam, he is also object of knowledge. Is it clear? The flow is clear? 14th shloka. Sarvatah panipadam tat.
Sarvatah panipadam tat.
Sarvatok shishiromukham.
Sarvatok shishiromukham.
Sarvatah shruti malloke.
Sarvatah shruti malloke.
Sarvam avrityatishthati.
Sarvam avrityatishthati.
Sarvatah panipadam tat. Means everywhere are his hands and legs. Super soul is everywhere. So with hands, what do you do? You work, you do so many activities. With your legs, you move from one place to another place, right? So, sarvatah panipadam means there is no place where Krishna cannot go. There is no work that Krishna cannot do. Is it clear? Sarvatah panipadam, that means he... Now, if I am sitting here, then I can work here only. Whether I am reading the book or lifting the book or lifting the table or typing on the laptop or whatever, my hands are here only. My hands can work in this small space only. But the super soul is everywhere, his hands are everywhere. He can accomplish any work. And his legs are everywhere, means he can move anywhere. Okay. Sarvatokshi shiromukham, his eyes are everywhere. Akshi, shira, his faces are everywhere. Shira is head, then mukha is face. So his eyes, his face, his head is everywhere. Means he is all pervading basically. Sarvatah shrutimal loke, everywhere are his shrutis, ears. He can hear from anywhere. Now when I am speaking here, if you are sitting in front of me, you can hear the class. If you are 1 kilometer away on the other side of the property, you go to Goshala, there you cannot hear. So, but he can hear from there also. So everything that is being spoken by every person at any time can be heard by the Supreme Lord. Because as super soul, he is there everywhere. Sarvam avritya tishthati, because he is all pervading. Avritya means he has covered everything. He is there everywhere. Because he is there everywhere, his hands are everywhere, his legs are everywhere, his eyes are everywhere, his faces are everywhere. Everything is everywhere. Clear? Just that he is distributed everywhere, it does not mean that he has no localized personal existence. Some people will think like that also. Or some people will think that he is not a person. How can a person be everywhere? If he is all pervading, he is not a person. No, he is a person. With hands, with legs and everything. He can create his replicas everywhere. He can expand by the influence of his energy everywhere. Now I am sitting here and speaking. Somebody recorded my voice and then that voice is being played at a different place. So that voice is mine only. If you are hearing from that recording, you say that so-and-so person has spoken this. Prabhupada has given this example. Okay. So it's a person speaking. But actually the person is not speaking. Person is doing something else at some other place. His energy is doing the needful there. His recording is doing the needful there. You hear recordings, right? So similarly, the Lord may be situated at one place in his abode, eternal abode, and doing so many leelas. But his energies are everywhere. His partial expansions are everywhere. As Bhagavan, he may be situated in the spiritual world. But as Paramatma, his expansion, he expands himself into every single living entity's heart. There is Paramatma in your heart, there is Paramatma in my heart. There is Paramatma in your heart also. Means three lords are there? No, only one lord. Okay, his replicas are there everywhere. So his hands are there everywhere, his legs are everywhere. He is a person, wherever he is. So just because he is expanded and he is pervading everywhere, that does not mean he has no personal existence. He is not a person. One cannot conclude like that. So, internet is everywhere. Internet is not a person. Internet is being operated by a person. So, but the Lord, when he expands everywhere, he can manifest from anywhere. Okay. So, because he is everywhere, and Hiranyakashipu challenged Prahlad. So if he's everywhere, show me in this pillar. Yeah, why not? He's there in pillar. And Hiranyakashipu just with his fist, he just punched that pillar, and the pillar broke apart, and the Narasimhadeva manifested from there. He's everywhere. He's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. He's omniscient. He's all knowledgeable. So these are various qualities of the Lord. Next, 15th shloka.
सर्वेन्द्रियगुणाभासं
सर्वेन्द्रियविवर्जितं
सर्वेन्द्रियविवर्जितं
असक्तं सर्वभृच्चैव
असक्तं सर्वभृच्चैव
निर्गुणं गुणभोक्तृच
निर्गुणं गुणभोक्तृच
सर्वेन्द्रियगुणाभासं सर्व मीन्स ऑल इंद्रिय मीन्स सेंसेस गुणाभासं सो गुणाभासं मीन्स ही इज द सोर्स ऑफ ऑल सेंसेस. He is Hrishikesha. He is the master of senses. He is the controller of senses. He is the source of all senses. Sarvendriya vivarjitam. And is devoid of all senses. So now some people may interpret this line as he has no senses. He is not a person. In the previous shloka only Sarvataha Panipadam Tuti is there. His hands are everywhere. His legs are everywhere. If a person has two legs and two hands, and they are at one place, you are considering him person. If a person has legs and hands and faces and eyes everywhere, is he not a person? He is of course a person. He is the supreme person. He is the greatest person. He is the source of all persons. So, but what is this line? Sarvendriya vivarjitam. He is devoid of senses. That means he is devoid of material senses. You and me have material senses. We have material eyes. We have material hands. We have material head. If somebody takes a hammer and puts on our head will break. Okay? If somebody takes some nails and then pierces our eyes are gone. But the Lord's eyes are spiritual. Okay? Lord's hands and heads and legs and hands, everything is spiritual. So when we say that Sarvendriya Vivarjitam, he does not have material senses like you and me. He has spiritual senses by which he can be everywhere. With material senses, we can be at one place only. But the Lord has spiritual senses, that's why he can be everywhere. Spiritual senses are all pervading. Asaktam sarvabhrucheva. Asaktam means he is unattached. Sarvabhrucheva, he is the maintainer of all. Sarvabhrut, bhuta bhrannacha bhutasto. We see, right? So he is the maintainer of everything, maintainer of everyone. So he is unattached and he is the maintainer. When you maintain something, you could become attached. You have created this building and you are maintaining this building. There is some attachment to this building, is it not? But the Lord is maintaining so many buildings. There are 14 planetary systems within this universe. Like this, there are hundreds and thousands and billions of universes. He is maintaining all of them. He is Srishtikarta. He is Sthitikarta, he is Layakarta also. He is creating, he is maintaining and he is destroying. So if he has attachment to what he is maintaining, how can he destroy? You are maintaining this building and if somebody asks you to destroy that building, you will feel unhappy. No, no, I cannot destroy. It is my creation. I am maintaining this. How can I destroy? But the Lord is detached. He can create, he can maintain and he can destroy also. So he is asaktam. Nirgunam guna bhokturcha. Nirgunam. He is devoid of material modes. Or nirgunam. Nihi nischayena. Means he is definitely the master of modes. Guna bhokturcha. So he is transcendental to modes. Okay. So nirgunam is he is transcendental to them. Guna bhoktur is he is master of modes. Although he is master of modes, he is beyond the modes. Fine. So these are some more qualities. Next shloka is 16th shloka. So Lord is not contaminated by material modes. He is not affected by material modes. We are affected by sattva guna, rajo guna, tamo guna. 16th shloka. Bahirantascha bhutanam
Bahirantascha bhutanam
Acharam charame vacha
Acharam charame vacha
Sukshmata sukshatmat tad अविग्नेयम् दूरस्थम् चांतिके चतत्
दूरस्थम् चांतिके चतत्
बहिर अंतस्य भूतानाम् बहिर मीन्स आउटसाइड, अंतः मीन्स इनसाइड. बहिरंतश्च भूतानां, ही इज इनसाइड एंड आउटसाइड ऑफ ऑल मूविंग एंड नॉन मूविंग एंटिटीज. ही इज इनसाइड एंड ही इज आउटसाइड ऑफ ऑल चरा एंड अचरा, मूविंग एंड नॉन मूविंग एंटिटीज. एंड ही मूव्स एंड ही डज नॉट मूव ऑल्सो. चरम च अचरम एव च, और अचरम चरम एव च. ही इज इमूवेबल एंड ही इज मूवेबल ऑल्सो. सो ऑल कॉन्ट्रडिक्शंस आर रिकनसाइल्ड इन द पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ गॉड इफ वी accept his inconceivable potency. How can he be movable and how can he be immovable also simultaneously? He is inconceivable. He cannot completely understand. He can move, he cannot, he need not move also. It's up to him. So we discussed all this earlier also. Sukshat sukshmatva tad avigneyam. He is subtle. Sukshma means subtle. And tad avigneyam, he is not knowable by material senses. Avigna means you cannot understand him. Krishna himself said, nateva dhusraganaah prabhavam na maharshayah. Avigneyam means you cannot understand him by material senses. Durastham cha antikecha tat. So he is far, far away and he is also so near to you. He is far away. His Goloka planet is somewhere else. You are stuck in this material world. But he is so near to you, he is staying right in your heart. He is there also, he is here also. You see? So that's how the Lord can simultaneously be everywhere and within your heart also, and he is so far from you also. Avibhaktam cha bhuteshu.
Avibhaktam cha bhuteshu.
Vibhaktam iva cha sthitam.
Vibhaktam iva cha sthitam.
Bhuta bhartrucha tadgneyam.
Bhuta bhartrucha tadgneyam.
Grashishno prabhavishnu cha.
Grashishno prabhavishnu cha.
Bhuta bhartrucha tadgneyam. Okay. He is never divided, although he appears to be divided amongst all beings. He is one. Now you see, avibhaktam cha bhuteshu. Avibhakta. Avibhakta means one who can be divided. Now he is there in your heart. He is there in your heart. He is there in your heart. He is there in my heart. Means the Lord is divided. You take one cake, you cut into so many pieces and then give one piece to everybody. Everybody is eating cake. You say like that. The original cake is gone. So when you distribute one piece of cake to everybody, means the original cake is loses its existence. Everybody has cake now. There is no cake here. But the Lord stays as one complete unit, and from his complete personality, so many complete personalities will emanate and accompany each of us. So he is divided amongst all of us, but he is not divided at all. He is available for all of us, but he himself can separately exist doing all his leelas. Okay, he is never divided, although he appears to be divided amongst all of us. He is situated as one. So super soul is everywhere means he appears to be divided, but he is not. Then bhuta bhartrucha tadgneyam grashishnu prabhavishnucha. He is the maintainer of all beings and also their destroyer also in the form of kalashakti. We discussed in the previous chapter, right? Kalosmi loka kshayatkrit pravruddho lokan samahartum iha pravruttaha. He is the time factor that destroys everything. Last shloka in this series. ज्योतिषामपि तज्ज्योतिः.
ज्योतिषामपि तज्ज्योतिः.
तमसः परमुच्यते.
तमसः परमुच्यते.
ज्ञानं ज्ञेयं ज्ञानगम्यं.
ज्ञानं ज्ञेयं ज्ञानगम्यं.
हृदि सर्वस्य हृदि सर्वस्य विष्ठितं.
हृदि सर्वस्य विष्ठितं.
ज्योतिषामपि तज्ज्योतिः. हि इज द सोर्स ऑफ ऑल ल्यूमिनरीज. देयर आर सो मेनी ज्योतिषास. हि इज द ज्योति ऑफ ऑल ऑफ देम. तमसः पारमुच्यते. ही इज बियॉन्ड द डार्कनेस ऑफ मैटर. ज्ञानम ज्ञेयम. ज्ञान मीन्स हिज नॉलेज. ज्ञेय मीन्स हिज द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ नॉलेज. ज्ञान गम्यम. ही इज द गोल ऑफ नॉलेज. बाय डेवलपिंग ऑल नॉलेज यू आर सपोज टू नो हिम ओनली. ओके, व्हाट इज दैट साउंड? ओके, नो प्रॉब्लम. सो यू सी, सर्वस्य चाहम हृदि सन्निविष्टो मत्तः स्मृतिर् ज्ञानम अपोहनम च वेदैश्च सर्वैर् अहमेव वेद्यो वेदांतकृत् वेद विदेव चाहम. ही इज द कंपाइलर ऑफ वेदांत. ही इज द नोयर ऑफ वेदांत. बाय स्टडींग ऑल वेदस ही इज टू बी नोन. समथिंग सिमिलर इज मेंशन्ड हियर आल्सो. ज्ञानम ज्ञेयम. He is knowledge. He is the object of knowledge. And Jnanagamyam, he is the goal of all knowledge. By developing all knowledge, you are supposed to attain him. Your knowledge is Krishna. Your object of knowledge is Krishna. Your aim or goal of knowledge is Krishna. Hridi sarvasya vishthitam. He is situated in the heart of everybody. That is the super soul who is an expansion of Krishna. Is it clear? So these five shlokas describe the qualities of the super soul. So we are discussing the topic of Jnayam, the object of knowledge. So the objects of knowledge are twofold. One, Jivatma. Two, Paramatma. We discussed about Atma and we are discussing about Paramatma. So that is completed. 19th shloka.
इति क्षेत्रं तथा ज्ञानं
ज्ञेयं चोक्तं समासतः
मद्भक्त
एव विज्ञाय
मद्भावायोपपद्यते.
सो दस द फील्ड ऑफ एक्टिविटीज द बॉडी नॉलेज एंड द नोएबल हैव बीन समरीली डिस्क्राइब्ड बाय मी. ओनली माय डिवोटीज कैन अंडरस्टैंड दिस थरोली and thus attain by nature. So Krishna very clearly says, iti kshetram tatha jnanam. He explained about kshetra, he explained about jnanam. Gneyam choktam samasatha, he also spoke about gneyam. Mad bhakta etad vignaya, only devotees can understand this knowledge. So far he completed four topics, kshetra, kshetragna, jnana, gneya. Okay. So mad bhava yopapadyate, if you understand them in truth, you can even attain Krishna also. So knowledge is nothing but the preliminary stage of understanding devotional service perfectly. Basically, by developing the knowledge about all these aspects, you are supposed to be serving Krishna. Ultimately, come to the stage of performing loving devotional service to Krishna. Okay? Just acquiring knowledge is not sufficient. So, we completed up to
9.
नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय.
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय.
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय.
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय.
हरे कृष्ण. 20th श्लोक. प्रकृतिं पुरुषं चैव विद्यनादि उभावपि विकारांश्च गुणांश्चैव विद्धि प्रकृति संभवान्. प्रकृतिं पुरुषं चैव विद्धि अनादि उभावपि. सो इन दिस चैप्टर 13th चैप्टर Prabhupada gives this title, Nature, the Enjoyer and Consciousness. So in this chapter, Arjuna asked 6 questions in the beginning. Prakriti, Purusha, then Jnana, Jnaya, then Kshetra and Kshetragna. Krishna answered these questions and elaborately explained on the first, on these four topics, Kshetra, Kshetragna, Jnanam and Jnayam. Kshetra is the material body. Kshetragna means the knower of the material body, which is the super soul or the soul, both of them. Then Jnana is knowledge of the body, means matter, and the spirit soul, and the supremely spiritual, the Lord also. Okay, so this is Jnanam. Jnayam is also that only. Name that object of knowledge is then the super soul and the soul. So knowledge is that what you are supposed to know. And also while describing Jnanam, Krishna also described 20 qualities that will help you acquire Jnana, or 20 qualities you need to possess to have knowledge. Or these are also considered as 20 qualities which are aspects of knowledge. Okay. So it's both the process of attaining knowledge and it is also part of knowledge also. Then we have already discussed Jnayam, the object of knowledge. in that we discussed the qualities of the soul and the super soul. Now Krishna is answering the remaining two questions. What are they? Prakriti and Purusha. In the 20th sloka, Krishna is saying, Prakriti and Purusha both are eternal. Purusha is eternal, we understand. The Supreme Lord is eternal. How can Prakriti be eternal? We'll discuss. So Krishna has described about Paramatma from 14th sloka till 18th sloka. Okay. And Paramatma is the knower of the field. Now he will describe how Jiva, who is also the knower of field, comes in contact with Prakriti or Maya. So this Purusha is the Supreme Lord. That Purusha, the Supreme Lord, is not entangled by Maya. But the Jiva, who is also knower of field, so he will get entangled by Maya or Prakriti. Let us discuss 20th sloka. Prakritim Purusham Chaiva Vidhyanadi Ubhavapi. So Prakriti is material nature, and Purusha, now we need to understand the word Purusha basically means enjoyer or controller, proprietor, master. Or Purusha is a word which is often used to indicate a male, a man, a male person. So, oftentimes this Purusha word is used to indicate the Supreme Lord. But many times Purusha word is also used to indicate the Jiva. The Jiva is also called Purusha. Okay. Why? Not that he is the proprietor or controller or master or enjoyer. Not that he is the supreme male. But just because he has Purusha mentality. The scriptures also address the Jiva as Saha, means he. In Sanskrit, Sa is used, means he. I mean, we also discussed in the 7th chapter that Jiva is Prakriti, not Purusha. In the 7th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna describes, I have two kinds of nature. You see, one is 7.4, Bhumirapo analo vayu khammano buddhirevacha hankara itiyamme bhinna prakriti rashtata. That is bhinna prakriti. Which is my separated energy. Prakriti is energy, Purusha is energetic. So the Lord is energetic, the Jiva is not energetic. He is also energy. So thus Jiva is also Prakriti. So the material Prakriti, which is Bhinna Prakriti, separated material energy of the Lord. But Aparaya Mitastvanyam Prakritim Vidhime Param. There is another Prakriti, which is superior Prakriti, that is Para Prakriti, or the Jivas. So, Jiva Bhutam Mahabaho Yedam Dharyate Jagat, Krishna says. All the Jivas belong to my superior Prakriti. So, when we say Prakriti, the word Prakriti primarily indicates material nature, but the Jivas also are a part of Prakriti. And when you say Purusha, primarily the word Purusha indicates the Supreme Lord, but sometimes Jiva is also called Purusha. So, sometimes Jiva is called Prakriti, sometimes Jiva is called Purusha. Purusha. How is it justified? The simple answer is, technically speaking, Jiva is Prakriti of the Lord. According to the Jiva's constitutional position, the Jiva is the energy of the Lord, not the energetic Lord himself. Okay. Jiva is spiritual. Okay. But he belongs to spiritual energy of the Lord. And Prakriti is material energy of the Lord. In Gita context. But because this Jiva, who belongs to Prakriti, develops Purusha mentality or develops a tendency to enjoy, be the proprietor, master, controller, etc. So according to that understanding, Jiva is sometimes addressed as Prakriti. So Jiva, when the Jiva is called Purusha, then we need to understand it is indicating his Purusha mentality, not his being Purusha. So material Prakriti and the Jivas. Material nature is Prakriti. The Jivas are living entities which are Purusha. Both are Anadi. Means beginningless. Being the energies of the Supreme Lord. See, energies. Their transformations. See this. Vikaramsa gunamsaiva vidhi Prakriti sambhavan. Their transformations are Vikaras. And the material modes, Gunas, are products of material nature. So both their transformations of both Prakriti and Purusha and the material modes, they are products of material nature. prakriti. Now you see, Prabhupada and the Acharyas describe this, the mystery of material creation. Before the creation, the material nature and the living entities were absorbed within the Supreme Lord. In the second canto of Bhagavatam, we already studied that the entire universe and all the living entities within the universe are merged within the body of Mahavishnu. From the body of Mahavishnu, the universe comes out. First as Pradhana, then Mahatattva, then Ahankara in three modes, and then becoming a universe. And the Lord will inject into this material nature all the living entities. So both the living entities, which are here addressed as Purusha, and the Prakriti, the universe, so both of them are coming from the Lord. So these so-called Purushas or the Jivas are coming from the Supreme Purusha, who is Purushottama. At the time of creation, they were manifested as living entities, and the living entities were again given a chance to act in the material world and prepare themselves to enter into the spiritual world. Then Purusha is actually the Supreme Lord, and the Jiva is not the Supreme Lord, not the master of the material creation, but he has the tendency to think himself to be the master. So that's why Purusha word refers to both soul and super soul. You understood? Constitutional position, Jiva is the Prakriti. In the conditioned state, the Jiva is Purusha. 21.
कार्यकारणकर्तृत्वे
हेतुः प्रकृतिर् उच्यते
हेतुः प्रकृतिर् उच्यते
पुरुषः सुखदुःखानां
पुरुषः सुखदुःखानां
भोक्तृत्वे हेतुः उच्यते
भोक्तृत्वे हेतुः उच्यते.
In the 21st shloka, Krishna is describing the roles of Purusha and Prakriti. He says कार्यकारणकर्तृत्वे हेतुः प्रकृतिर् उच्यते. In the first two lines, he speaks about the Prakriti. Prakriti or material nature is said to be the cause of Karya and Karana. Okay. So, Karya is the effect, Karana is the cause. Karana means cause. Karya is the effect of the cause, which is basically the work which is done. The result of the cause. Okay. So, this karya karana kartritve hetur, the hetu, the ultimate cause of all causes and effects within this material realm is Prakriti. When you mix few ingredients and make the sabji, the ingredients are the cause, and the sabji or the vegetable, the preparation that comes out, the eatable dish that comes out is the effect. So the result, the cause of both is Prakriti, material nature. So from the material nature only, all these ingredients, whether it is vegetables or the spices that you put or the fire that you use to boil all these things or the oil that pours in, that you put into it. So all these ingredients and the facilities to process these ingredients, everything is coming from Prakriti. Okay. So when it becomes sabji, so when you boil this sabji in potato in a bowl of water, it becomes very soft. Before it was hard, later it became soft. The taste changes. Okay. So the effect of it is also coming from Prakriti. Because for the potato, if you boil a stone, it will not become soft. It's a potato, you put a stone there. Or you cut paneer pieces and then process it. You boil them or fry them. It will have a certain taste. You take a cardboard sheet and then cut it. You take this plywood, okay, cut it. Same size as paneer pieces, cubes. You boil them. Will it have the same effect? Certainly not. So, the tendency to give very delicious taste, the quality of giving us taste when boiled, is given by Prakriti to the sabji, to the paneer piece or whatever. But that is not given to this wood. So we need to understand that the ingredients of a food preparation are coming from Prakriti. When they are, the way they are processed is also happening under the superintendence of Prakriti. under the facilitation of Prakriti. Superintendent is Supreme Lord anyways. So material nature is both the cause and effect. It's the cause of all causes and effects. If you boil this at this temperature, this will be the outcome. If you boil it with more temperature, this will be the outcome. So all these things are happening because of Prakriti. Purushah sukha dukkhanam bhoktatve hetu ruchyate. Now Krishna describes about Purusha. Purusha is the living entity, Jiva. He is the cause of his own happiness and distress due to his enjoying propensity. Purushah sukha dukkhanam. Purusha, the conditioned soul, undergoes lot of sukha and dukkha. Bhoktrutve hetu ruchyate. And he is the cause of all of them. So ultimately, earlier we discussed, right? That Prakriti is the cause, gunas are the cause. The conditioned soul thinks himself to be the cause unnecessarily. What is that sloka?
Mayadhyasana.
No.
Ahankara vimudhatma.
Exactly. How does it begin? Ahankara vimudhatma kartaham iti manyate. Prakritehe kriyamanani gunaihi karmani sarvashah. अहंकार विमूढात्मा कर्ताहम् इति मन्यते. सो एवरीथिंग इज बीइंग कैरिड आउट बाय प्रकृति एंड जीवा इज एक्सपीरियंसिंग हैप्पीनेस और डिस्ट्रेस बट फूलिशली अंडर द इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ फॉल्स ईगो अहंकार विमूढात्मा द जीवा थिंग्स दैट आई एम कर्ता आई एम द डूअर ऑफ एवरीथिंग बट दैट्स व्हाट वी लर्नड अर्लियर बट नाउ वी आर लर्निंग दैट पुरुषः सुख दुःखानां भोक्तृत्वे हेतुरुच्यते. पुरुष द लिविंग एंटिटी is the cause of his own happiness and distress. Earlier, Prakriti is said to be the cause. But all these things are reconciled and elaborately described earlier in the third and fifth chapter especially. The living entity is said to be the cause because the living entity desires some material enjoyment. The Prakriti is said to be the cause because the Prakriti facilitates those desires. The Supreme Lord Krishna or the super soul is said to be the cause because he sanctions those desires. Thus all three are doers of an action. For an action to be carried out, it's not the action of only one person. You are doing something, you are not the only cause of your action. You are the cause in the sense that you desire to do that activity. You wanted to type something, but unless you have a laptop in front of you, you cannot type. Laptop or phone or iPad or whatever, you need to have some typing object, right? Typing machine to type something. Then who made that? There are many other people. The manufacturer has made it. Somebody has supplied the electricity to charge it. Somebody has created the software, Word or PPT or whatever for you to type. So there are so many people involved. So all those people or personalities and the systems that are created by them are facilitating you to do one little typing work. So, like, who is kind of assisting you in essence? There are so many personalities, the jivas and Prakriti. So, the jiva with his intelligence may create a laptop, but for that, for him to create, he needs the ingredient, right? The plastic material is there. All the other wires inside and the capacitor and resistor, these are so many big circuits there inside. All these are available in the material nature. Okay, and the material laws are there. They are understanding the material laws and they are trying to utilize them to fulfill certain purposes. Fine. So thus, whatever we do, it is being facilitated by a combination of both Prakriti and Purusha. Okay. So without Prakriti's assistance, this Purusha, this jiva cannot do much, cannot do anything. Okay, and without the jiva doing something on the Prakriti, this material elements, the Prakriti will not operate on its own. All this plastic and everything will not assemble on their own to perform a laptop. Jiva has assembled them. So without a spirit entering the matter, matter will not function. Without the matter having certain properties ultimately induced by the Lord, the Prakriti, the Purusha also cannot work anything, cannot do any work. But the Supreme Lord Krishna He doesn't need the assistance of Prakriti to do anything. He can create. Now, for you to create a garland, so you need flowers from different plants. Okay? But now, you may pluck your flowers and you may say, I have actually made this garland. I have plucked the flowers on my own. But did you create the flower? No. Did you create the thread? No. Did you create the needle? No. You just brought together and then made into garland. But Krishna can create the flower, Krishna can create the thread, Krishna can create the needle also. And without creating all these three also, you can make a garland. Okay. So, for you to cook something, a farmer has to grow vegetables. Some gas company has to give you gas. And some other stove company has to provide a stove for you. And the kitchen department has to make a kitchen for you. So like that, you are dependent to just make one preparation. You are dependent on multiple factors. But Krishna can create Sabji without depending on anyone. Krishna can create Brahma. Vishnu can create Brahma without the assistance of Lakshmi. That's the difference between this Purusha and that Purusha. So basically, in this shloka, Karya karana kartritve hetar prakriti ruchyate, purusha sukadukkana bhoktritve hetar ruchyate. The roles of prakriti and purusha are described. Prakriti is said to be the cause of all causes and effects. And purusha is said to be the cause of his own happiness and distress. So because of prakriti's influence, everything is happening here. And that is giving us happiness or distress. So prakriti is the cause of my happiness and distress also. No, you are the cause of your own happiness and distress. Because you have come in contact with Prakriti in a certain way. Prakriti has made a system. If you touch a hot object, your hand will burn. Okay? If you touch an object which is regular room temperature, your hand will not burn. Now, it's your choice. You chose to put your hand on the frying pan and then your hand got burnt. Prakriti is not the cause. Ultimately, Prakriti is the cause in one sense. Because when you put a pan under above fire, the pan will become heated up. That does not mean Prakriti is the cause of your burning of hand, your happiness or distress. Your choice. So you are the cause in the sense that you have chosen to do some activity that gives you happiness or distress. Prakriti is the cause in the sense that Prakriti only creates all this phenomena. Ultimately, the Supreme Lord is the cause of all causes because He has invested the desiring capacity in you. He has invested the facilitating capacity in Prakriti. So, you have your independence. Prakriti has its own rules and regulations how it functions. And the Lord is sanctioning according to your desires. Okay? You are the cause of your happiness and distress. So, now, Prakriti is the cause of Jiva's unfortunate condition in the world by offering him a body. Body is considered to be Karya. The senses which produce happiness and distress, they are Karana. And the presiding deities of the senses, Kartur. Jiva suffers or enjoys due to his misidentification with the body produced by Prakriti. So, in this body, the body itself is called Karya, the senses are called Karana, and the presiding deities of senses are called Kartra. Okay. So, this is some technical explanation. That is the relationship between Jiva and Prakriti. But to make it very simple, the Jiva has desires to enjoy separately from God, independent of God, and he wants to experience some material enjoyment. And Prakriti is facilitating that enjoyment under the sanction of Lord. 22nd shloka. Purushaha Prakriti Sthohim Bhunte Prakriti Jan Gunan Karanam Guna Sangosya Sada Sadhyoni Janmashu Prakriti Purushaha Prakriti Sthohi. The living entity is situated in the material nature, material body. Purushaha Prakriti Sthohi. Bhunte Prakriti Jan Gunan. So, although the living entity is situated in the material body through which he is experiencing everything, happiness and distress, ही थिंक्स दैट ही इज एंजॉयिंग द थ्री मोड्स ऑफ प्रकृति घूमते प्रकृति जान गुणान ही थिंक्स ही इज एंजॉयिंग इन द थ्री मोड्स वर्ण प्रकृति कारणम गुणसंगोस्य दिस इज ड्यू टू हिज एसोसिएशन विद मटीरियल मोड्स गुणसंग मीन्स एसोसिएशन विद द मटीरियल मोड्स The reason for his enjoyment or distress or any other experience in this world is because of his association with the three modes. What are the three modes? Sattvaguna, Rajaguna, Tamoguna. If you associate with Sattvaguna, you will attain happiness and knowledge. If you associate with Rajaguna, there is some other result. If you associate with Tamoguna, there is some other result. All that we will see in the next chapter. Modes are elaborately described in the next chapter. So the soul is changing bodies. Under the influence of material desires, the living entity is born. Sometimes as demigod, sometimes as a man, sometimes as a woman, sometimes as a bird, beast, etc. Aquatic. And in all cases, the living entity thinks himself to be the master of his circumstances. In whichever species the living entity is in, the living entity starts thinking that I am the master, I am the controller, I am the proprietor of this house, I am the boss of these people, I am the owner of this property, like that. So yet, he is ultimately under the influence of material modes and material nature. Now, somebody may think that I am the owner of this building. He is very proud of his the ownership. But when earthquake comes, the building is collapsed. Is he the owner? So, Prakriti ultimately is facilitating your ownership mentality, your proprietorship mentality, your controlling mentality, your enjoying mentality. And you are thinking that you are the cause of everything. I have made this building from scratch. I have given the layout for its foundation. I have purchased all the, ingredients to make the building. All the cement bags or the iron or the stones, rubble, everything I have done it. I have coordinated the whole construction. But did you coordinate the earthquake? You didn't coordinate. But because of earthquake, just one little jerk in the earth planet, your building is collapsed. How come you are the controller? So it is very foolish on the part of the person to think that he is the proprietor, he is the master, he is the controller. We are constantly being controlled by the material nature. Because of our controllership mentality. You see, the Purusha, means the living entity, thinks that I am enjoying nature. See, I came here and cool breeze is coming, I am enjoying, I am the enjoyer. The cool breeze will become hot wind in some time. Now morning it's around 8:30, 9 o'clock. It's pleasant now. Come here at 12 o'clock or 2 o'clock. Same place. You cannot sit and have class here. No, flowers are blossoming, you may get nice fragrance and the birds are chirping nicely. There is shadow here. It's very pleasant to sit here and then have Bhagavad Gita Katha. You cannot focus on the class when you come and sit here at 2 o'clock. So when the sun is above your head, you are sweating. You are not the controller. So we are constantly being controlled by material nature. But foolishly we are thinking that we are the controllers of nature. So, this will continue. Once we give up that controllership mentality, then we will not be under the control of material nature. Material nature will control only those people who think that they are controllers. But if you don't think that you are the controller, and if you start thinking that Krishna is the supreme controller, Ishvaraha Paramaha Krishna, then material nature will not control you. Krishna will control you directly. You understood? Sadasad yoni janmasu. Because of this controllership mentality, because of the association with the modes, the living entity is going into different species. He meets good and evil in various species. So, this is due to jiva's misidentification with Prakriti and misuse of minute independence. 22nd shloka we discussed. 23rd shloka. Upadrishtanumantacha भर्ता भोक्ता महेश्वरः परमात्मेति चाप्युक्तो देहेस्मिन् पुरुषः परः उपद्रष्टा हनुमन्ता च उपद्रष्टा इज ओवरसीयर नाउ दिस इज अबाउट द रियल पुरुष द 22nd श्लोक 21st श्लोक एंड इवन 20th श्लोक आल्सो You heard about one Purusha who is not actually the real Purusha. He is Purusha only by name. He is Purusha only by his mood.
Misnomer.
He is Purusha because he has Purusha mentality. But he is not the real Purusha. The real Purusha is described in 23rd Shloka. You call him Purusha because you think that he is Purusha. If you call him by some other name, he may not be responding to you. Oh, Purusha, come here. So he thinks that he's boss, and you call him Das, come here. I'm not Das. You call me boss, then only I'll respond. Then, okay, you call him boss, then he'll come. So basically, when scriptures are addressing the living entity as Purusha, they are just acknowledging his Purusha mentality. He's not Purusha. Krishna is the only Purusha. So the super soul is the real Purusha. So he is the Upadrashta, means he is the overseer. Anumanta, he is the permitter of Jiva's actions. He is giving you Anumati. He is called Anumanta because he is giving you Anumati. Anumati means permission. Okay, fine, you can enjoy in this way. He is Bharta, he is the supreme master. Next is Bhokta, he is the supreme enjoyer. Maheshwara, he is the supreme proprietor. See these words. He is Upadrashta, Anumanta, Bharta, Bhokta, Maheshwara. Master, enjoyer, proprietor, controller. Everything is he only. Paramatmeti chapyukto. Such a person is called Paramatma. The super soul. Dehe asmin purushaha paraha. He is there in the deha. Purusha is there. Regular purusha is there. The soul is there. But the param purusha is also there. He is described as purushaha paraha. He is para purusha. Parapurusha is para means not different purusha. Parapurusha has a different usage. So purushaha paraha means he is transcendental purusha. He is the real purusha. So within this body, which is made of prakriti, there is one purusha who is the materialistic conditioned living entity, the jiva. And there is transcendental purusha who is the Supreme Lord Krishna. So that is 23rd shloka. The fact is that every individual living entity is eternally part and parcel of the Supreme Lord, and both of them are very intimately related as friends. But the living entity has the tendency to reject the sanction of the Supreme Lord and act independently in an attempt to dominate nature. And because he has this tendency, he is called marginal energy of the Supreme Lord. Although he is also energy, but he is not counted as material energy. He is counted as marginal energy. From outside he gives instructions as stated in Bhagavad Gita, and from within he tries to convince the conditioned soul that his activities in the material world are not conducive to real happiness. Now the super soul is described in this shloka. What does super soul do? Super soul gives us inspiration from within. It's not worth enjoying in this material world, because the so-called enjoyment in this world is also distress. So he gives us that inspiration. Whenever we are trying to do something wrong, he will give us inspiration from within. Oh, this is wrong, don't do this. Then from outside he is giving us instructions of Bhagavad Gita. Krishna is standing in front of us, in front of Arjuna, and then giving us instructions of Bhagavad Gita. So from outside, we are reading Bhagavad Gita. When you are reading Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is speaking to you. And from inside, Paramatma is there, giving us good intelligence, allowing us to assimilate what we read. So he is helping us from outside also, from inside also. Okay, that is super soul. 24th shloka.
सएवं वेत्ति पुरुषं
प्रकृतिं च गुणैः सह
सर्वथा वर्तमानोपि
नसभूयो विजायते. Can someone read the translation?
One who understands this philosophy concerning material nature, the living entity and the interaction of the modes of nature is sure to attain liberation. He will not take birth here again regardless of his present position.
So far, in the last four shlokas, 20, 21, 22, 23, Krishna gave understanding of Prakriti and Purusha. Prakriti is the material nature and Purusha is both the living entity and the Supreme Lord. It's like Kshetra and Kshetragna only. Kshetra is the material body which is made of material nature. Kshetragna means knower of body which is soul and super soul. Okay, both. Here also Prakriti is material nature, Purusha is both the living entity and the Supreme Lord. Fine. So one, if you understand this knowledge, what is the result? That is explained in the 24th sloka. See. Ya evam vetti purusham prakritim cha gunaihi saha. If you understand the knowledge about Purusha, Prakriti and Gunas of Prakriti, sarvatha vartamanopi nasa bhuyo bhavijayati. So, you will be surely attaining liberation without having to take birth again. So, having knowledge of Prakriti, Purusha and Gunas will help us come out of that entanglement. Means, not only having knowledge, you should act on that knowledge also. Also understand that the Purusha is just being entangled by Prakriti and we have to surrender to Supreme Purusha. You just put that knowledge into action and convert it into realization. Then you will not have to take birth again. Clear understanding of material nature, the super soul, the individual soul and their interaction makes one eligible to become liberated and turn to the spiritual atmosphere without being forced to retain this material nature. Prabhupada basically wrote the translation of the shloka in a more clear and explanatory terms. This is the result of knowledge. Fine. The purpose of knowledge is to understand distinctly that the living entity has by chance fallen into this material existence. By his personal endeavor in association with authorities, saintly persons and a spiritual master, he has to understand his position and then revert to spiritual consciousness or Krishna consciousness by understanding Bhagavad Gita as it is explained by the Personality of God. 25th Sloka. Dhyanenatmani pasyante kechit atmanam atmanam anye sankhyena yogena karma yogena chapare. Dhyanenatmani pasyanti, dhyanena, by meditation, atmani pasyanti, you will perceive the self. There are other methods also to attain this liberation. Some see Paramatma through meditation. Dhyanena atmani pasyanti. That dhyana is basically Ashtanga Yoga, which Krishna described in the 6th chapter. So one is dhyanena. Kechid atmanam atmana anye sankhyena yogena. And there is another method, which is Sankhya Yoga or Jnana Yoga. So sometimes you perceive Paramatma by meditation in dhyana yoga. Sometimes you understand the Lord by Jnana Yoga or Sankhya Yoga, by knowledge and analysis. Next, karma yogena chapare, and other people realize the Lord by karma yoga or nishkam karma yoga. So basically you will reach the Lord either through karma yoga or jnana yoga or dhyana yoga. But the best way of reaching the Lord is bhakti yoga. In this one sloka, Krishna mentioned all the other methods. This karma yoga, jnana yoga and ashtanga yoga. See this. The Lord informs Arjuna that the conditioned souls can be divided into two classes as far as man sets for absolute self-realization is concerned. Those who are atheists, agnostics and skeptics are beyond the sense of spiritual understanding. But there are others who are faithful in their understanding of spiritual life and they are called introspective devotees, philosophers and workers who have renounced fruitive results, karmis, jnanis and yogis. Simple. Those who always try to establish the doctrine of monism are also counted amongst atheists and agnostics. So, you know these terms, jnanis, karmis and yogis, we discussed before also. And Krishna himself has explained to us what is karma yoga, jnana yoga and dhyana yoga, ashtanga yoga. So, Krishna mentions those things also now, other methods. And continuing what he was trying to say in the 25th shloka, in the 26th shloka, Krishna speaks about other people. Anyetvevam ajanantah shrutvanyebhya upasate tepi chati tarantyeva mrityum shruti parayana anyetu evam ajanatah. Again, there are others who, although having knowledge, see this, ajanatah means without spiritual knowledge. Although they don't have knowledge, they worship the Supreme Lord by hearing about Him. See this, shrutva anye anebhyah upasati. Now, ajanatah, their knowledge, they don't have knowledge. A philosopher is there, a scientist is there, a big educator is there. Educationalist is there. So he can study a lot of literature and he can understand things with his intelligence. There is an illiterate person who may not understand much. He will come and sit in the class of devotees. He will just hear from advanced souls. What do the advanced devotees do? They will study the scriptures and give us the essence. Krishna says, Manmana bhava madbhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru satatam kirtayanto mam like that Krishna is teaching. Now you have the bandwidth, you have the intelligence to study Bhagavad Gita and understand the Sanskrit, understand the grammar and then figure out what Krishna is saying. But there are great souls who already figured out essence. Prabhupada is there. He has broken down the shloka into small words and given meaning of every single word and given a total English translation of the Sanskrit shloka and given a long one-page explanation of that shloka. Fine? So now you can hear them. You can read that and understand it. And there are some people who cannot even read this also. So when you are trying to read this and explain this to someone, other people will listen. So that thus they will get essence of what Krishna is speaking. So just by that spiritual hearing process, they can perfect their life. Although they are not very intellectual or philosophical or analytical, they still can perfect their lives by hearing from great souls. Okay. So that's why Acharyas have put all these great scriptures into writing. Earlier people will just hear and then follow. They will remember, they will repeat. But now even if it is written also, we forget and then we keep reminder in our phone and we write. That also we forget. We have forgotten that we have written. Okay, that is Kaliyuga memory. So what to speak of remembering just by hearing. So others don't have knowledge, but they worship the Supreme Lord just by hearing about Him. They surpass the path of repeated birth and death. See, Krishna promises, Tepi cha atitaranti eva mrityam shruti parayanaha. Because they are shruti parayanaha. You know Narayana Parayana, you know Vasudeva Parayana, you know Krishna Parayana. Means those who are dedicated to Vasudeva or Narayana or Krishna. Here this is Sriti Parayana. Sriti Parayana means those who are dedicated to the process of hearing about the Supreme Lord from realized devotees. Pibantiye Bhagavata Atmana Satam Kathamritam Shravana Puteshu Samhritam. That's why the whole process of hearing is glorified so many times in so many places in Bhagavatam, throughout Bhagavatam. Hearing has that potency. Just by the process of Shravanam, from bona fide, authentic sources, we can perfect our lives. We can cross over this material existence. See, atitaranti cha atitaranti eva mrityum. This world is called mrityu samsara, mrityu samsara sagarat. It's an ocean of birth and death. Death is ensured in this material world. It's not that only you have birth, there is death also. So we can be delivered from that by being Shruti Parayana. But that Shruti has to be done from authorized sources. Shrinvanti yenya vishaya kukatha mati ghanihi. If we hear from non-bona fide sources, materialistic sources, who do not have any devotion, they just speak bad topics, materialistic topics, selfish topics, topics that inspire us to engage in sense gratification and get more and more entangled in this material world. Mati ghanihi, our intelligence will get corrupted. श्रृण्वन्ति ये अन्य विषया कुकथामतिघ्नीः यास्तु श्रुता हतभगैर्भिरार्थसारा तांस्तां क्षिपन्ति अशरणेषु तमस्सु हन्त. यू रिमेम्बर दिस श्लोक? वेर इज इट फ्रॉम? थर्ड कैंटो वेर? 15th चैप्टर एग्जैक्टली. ब्रह्माजी स्पीक्स दिस वर्स. यन्न व्रजन्ति अघविदो रचनानुवादा श्रृण्वन्ति यन्य विषया कुकथामतिघ्नीः. दिस वन श्लोक tells us the importance of avoiding bad topics, hearing bad topics from materialistic people. If we hear like that, not only our intelligence will get corrupted, one can eventually go to hell also. One will lose all good fortune. One will eventually go to hell also because of attachment. Because hearing will follow some following. If you hear something and if you start appreciating, then you feel like doing things, acting on it. Okay. So, if you act on what you have heard from non-bona fide sources, basically you will act on a material plane, selfish plane. So, that will create a lot of entanglement, bondage in this world. So, one has to hear from bona fide sources. But by hearing from bona fide and authentic sources, spiritual subject matters that uplift one's consciousness, that will bring us closer to God, then we can definitely transcend this material realm and go to the spiritual world, as Krishna promises here. Although the common man is often not as capable as so-called philosophers, faithful hearing from an authoritative person will help one transcend this material existence and go back to Godhead, back to home. Prabhupada writes. That's how he concludes the purport. So, bhakti, perform bhakti by hearing. So in this small section from 20th shloka till 26th shloka, we discussed three things. One about prakriti, which is material nature. Second about purusha, which is the living entity. But third thing is there is a second purusha, that is the Supreme Lord Himself. So we discussed their characteristics, and because of Jiva's association with the prakriti, he is transmigrating from one body to another body, and Jiva is the cause of his own suffering and happiness. And the Prakriti is the cause of all causes. And the Supreme Purusha is the Supreme Lord, who is Apadrashta, Anumanta, Bharta, Bhokta, Maheshwara. He is the overseer, he is the master, he is the proprietor, he is the controller, he is the enjoyer. So by knowing about these three things, knowing about the soul, the super soul and the material nature, knowing about Prakriti and the two kinds of Purushas, one can transcend this material world. So that's how we need to develop knowledge about Prakriti, Purusha. And there are other methods also to transcend this world. Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga and Ashtanga Yoga. But even though you are not a philosopher or a Jnani or Karmi or Ashtanga Yogi or anything, if you are a Bhakta, who becomes a devotee only by hearing about Krishna, still you can transcend this material world. Because ultimately Bhakti is glorified. That is the simplicity of Bhakti. Thank you all very much. We will discuss the last section of this chapter in the next session. Hare Krishna.